Hi, in this video I'm going to add swimming to my third-person controller. Like in the first Soul Reaver game, the player is briefly stopped when diving into water, but shortly after they can freely swim in all 8 directions. On the surface they can only swim horizontally, but if they keep hitting the swim down button, they can eventually dive back in. Lastly, when underwater, the player can also charge for a small duration and then surge forward. So to reflect that, I came up with 4 new states: diving, swimming underwater, swimming off surface, and surging. To implement that, I start off by adding 3 new actions in the input map: swim up with space, swim down with control, and surge with Q. In the physics settings, I add a 3D physics layer called water and go into the controls script. Similar to other actions, I add Boolean flags and getters for new actions and determine their values in the process method. In the main scene, I change the type of the existing CSG mesh for the ground to a CSG box of size 100x100x12 so I can hollow it out for the water. Next, I create a CSG box with a size of 24x10x16, give it a brown material, set its operation to subtract, and move it around a little bit. Next, I create an area named water, set its collision layer to water and collision mask to player, give it a box collision shape with roughly the same as the CSG box, only a little shorter. I then create a mesh instance with a cube mesh that's slightly wider and deeper than the area, give it a transparent and unshaded material with a blue color, and finally move the area to the same place as the CSG box, but slightly lower so it's not level with the ground. With the water done, I go into the player scene and create an area called deep water detector with a spherical collision shape with a radius of 0.5 units and move it to the center of the player model. I also set its collision layer to player and collision mask to water. Next, I create another area called vertical surface detector with the same collision properties and position, but this time with a cylindrical collision shape with a radius of 0.42 and a height of 0.17. Finally, I add signal handlers for the area entered and area exited signals for both areas and just print out some text inside them. To test if this is working, I set the player's max jump count to 5 and launch the game. As you can see, both detectors are working properly. The existing horizontal movement code is slightly redundant, but it will get worse when I add other states, so I want to refactor it before moving on. For that, I go into the running state, copy the corresponding code to the base player state class under a method called setHorizontalMovement with the parameters speed, turn speed, camFollow speed, acceleration, and delta. I then clean up the code and move the moveRot field to the player script. With that done, I go back to the running script and replace the horizontal movement code to use this name method. I do the same thing for the root in-air state, but leave the dashing state because it acts slightly differently. Now I can start implementing swimming states. For that, I go into the player scene and add the root swimming state as well as the states for diving, underwater, on surface, and surging. I create a separate script for each state and start implementing the diving state. For that, I add 2 exports, top speed with a value of 6 and velocity threshold with a value of 0.5. Next, I add a physics process method, and in it I call the parent's physics process method, lerp the player's both horizontal and vertical velocities to 0 with a step of stop speed times delta, and finally check if the absolute of player's y velocity is less than or equal to the threshold, and if so, I just transition to the underwater state. In the underwater state, I'll just set the horizontal movement with some random values, and in the player script I get an already reference to the state machine, and in the area entered handler for the deep water detector, I transition to the diving state. Now when I run the game, I can see that when I jump into water, I will be refreshed stop, and then I'm able to move horizontally. To actually implement the underwater state, I define the necessary exports for horizontal movement with values that are less than actual on-ground movement, call the parent's physics process method, use the exports field for the set horizontal movement call, and move on to implementing vertical swimming. For that, I'm going to use 2 variables, vertical swim factor and vertical angle. If the player is pressing the swim up button, I set the factor to 1, if they're pressing the swim down button, I set it to -1, and otherwise I calculate this factor based on the camera's current vertical angle. I don't want the player to swim vertically unless they're holding down the forward or backwards movement button, so I retrieve the Y component of the horizontal movement speed and multiply its negative with the sine of the vertical angle to determine the vertical swimming factor. Finally, I loop the player's Y velocity to the vertical swimming factor multiplied by the swimming speed with a step of acceleration times delta and run the game. And now I can freely swim up or down when I hit the space or control buttons, or move the mouse around to swim in a certain direction when moving forward or backwards. Right now I can start swimming, but I can't get out of the water, so let's fix that. For that, I go into the on-surface state, add the horizontal movement exports with less turn and camel flow speeds, and also to define two more exports, jump power with a value of 30, and dive back speed with a value of negative 15. In the physics process method, I call the parent's physics process method, set the horizontal movement, and check if the player is pressing the jump button. If so, I set the player's Y velocity to jump power. If they're pressing the swim down button instead, I set it to dive speed and transition to the diving state. Otherwise, I just lerp the Y velocity towards 0 with a step of acceleration times delta, so the player stops moving vertically. To detect if the player is on the surface, I go back to the player script. Define a field called head above water with a value of false, set it to false when the surface detector area enters, and to true when it exits. Next, in the underwater state's physics process method, I check if this value is true, and if so, I transition to the on-surface state. Now when I run the game, I can jump out of the water when I'm on the water's surface, or just dive right back in. I only want the player to surge while they're in underwater, and after holding down the surge button briefly, with a cooldown of course, so for that, I go into the underwater script and add two export fields and two regular fields for the surge cooldown and duration. In the process method, I count towards the cooldown and check if the player is pressing the surge button. If so, I just increase the charge duration. If not, I check if the current state charge duration is greater than or equal to the expected duration and if the remaining cooldown is 0 or less. And if so, I reset both transitions and transition to the surging state. Otherwise, I just reset the charge duration to 0. While charging, I don't want the player to be able to swim, so in the physics process method, I replace the swim speed usages with a new variable called speed, which is set to 0 if the charge duration is greater than 0. For the surge itself, I go into the surging script, add an export field called surge power with a value of 80, and a field called will surge with a default value of false. In the physics process method, I call the parent method and transition to the parent state if will surge is false. If not, I set it to false and try to determine the direction of the surge based on the player and camera's rotations. For that, I take the forward vector, rotate it on the y-axis by the skin's rotation, set its y-component to the sine of the camera's vertical rotation, and then normalize it. Next, I move and slide the player based on this direction vector multiplied by the surge power, and I also update the y-velocity with the vector's y-component multiplied by the surge power. Finally, I transition to the underwater state. Now when I run the game, I can hold down the surge button to charge briefly, and when I release it, I am propelled forwards in the loop direction afterwards. Now that all states are implemented, it's time to add some visual feedback. For that, I first import the new player model with the swimming animations included. You can download this from the link in the description box below. In Godot, re-importing a newer version of an existing model is a bit tricky, but I found out that the best way to do it is like this. Drag the newer model to where it already exists, select the model file, go into the import options, hit re-import, double click on the file and click new inherited. This will open a new unsaved scene with the updated model, so to make sure it's all good, just check if the new animations are in. In my case they are, so I just close the unsaved scene without saving it. Next, do the same check for each scene that uses this model and save and reopen them. In this case, the player don and player scenes use this model, so I check if they received the new animations. With the model updated, it's time to add animations. For that, I go into the animation tree, increase the input count of the transition node to 5, and rename the new states as swimming and surging respectively. In the blend tree, I add two new blend space 1Ds with the name swimming and surging, and connect them to the appropriate slot on the transition node. Next, I go into the swimming blend space, add the swimming idle loop animation at position 0 and the swimming forward loop animation at 0.3. Next, I do the same thing for the surging space, but this time with surging loop and surging forward loop animations. To make sure they're good, I just play around with the state and blend positions. In the swimming script, I add an enter method, and in it, I set the current root state value of the animation tree to 3, which is the swimming state I've just made. In the process method of the underwater script, I set it to 4 if the player is pressing the search button, and to 3 if they are not. While I'm here, I also want to rotate the player's body vertically when swimming up or down, so for that, I add an exit method where I set the player's skin's rotation in the x-axis to 0. In the physics process method, I first retrieve the current blend position of the swimming node, lerp it towards the length of the player's velocity divided by 8 with a step of 4 times delta, and finally lerp the player's skin's rotation in the x-axis towards the vertical angle with a step of camfold of speed times delta. Finally, in the surging script, I set the blend position of the surging node to 1 when the state enters and to 0 when it exits, and run the game. And now all animations play accordingly. However, the surge still feels a little bit bland, so let's add simple visual effects. For that, I go into the player scene, add the new particles node under the skin, name it as VFX Surge, fix its visibility box, and move it slightly behind the player. Next, I set its draw path to a sphere with a radius of 0.1 and a height of 0.2, and a material that's transparent and unshaded with the vertex color set as the albedo, and the blend mode set to add. In the particles time section, I set the amount to 16, lifetime to 0.6, and randomness to 1. I set the direction to 1 in the z-axis, the spread to 15 degrees, and flatness to 0.4. I also set the gravity to 0, the initial linear velocity to 3, and the scale curve with a shark fin that drops down to 0 at around 0.75. As for the color, I set the overall color to a white with an alpha value around 100, and the color ramp to a 4-step gradient that goes from a darker blue to sky blue to a plain and transparent white. And finally, I just enabled the one shot. In the player script, I get alone the reference to this node, and in the enter method of the surging state script, I just set its emitting property to true. Now when I surge, I just leave some bubbles behind me. For the final visual feedback, I'll just apply a blue tint on the entire screen when the camera is underwater. For that, I go into the controllable camera scene, add a color rect called underwater effect, set it to full anchor, and set its color to a light blue with an alpha value around 90. Next, under the camera, I add an area called water detector, set its collision layer to none and its mask to water, and give it a box collision shape with a height and depth of 0.5 units. Next, I add handlers to the area entered and area exited signals of the area, and in them I just set the underwater effect as visible or hidden. Now when the camera goes into the water, the entire screen gets a blue tint. To finish off, I'm just going to add the touchscreen buttons for swimming and surging, and show or hide all buttons based on the player's current movement state. For that, I go into the player script, add a new signal called movement state change with a single parameter called new state, and in the ready method, I connect to the movement state machine's transition signal to a new method called onMoveStateChange, where I simply trigger this new signal. Next, I import the new icons to a new folder called icons under the assets folder, which you can download from the link in the description box, and once they are imported, I select them, go into the import tab, enable mipmaps and anisotropic, and click re-import so they look anti-aliased when in-game. Next, I go into the controls node and temporarily set the mobile controls node as visible, and update the textures of the existing buttons with the newer ones. After that, I add virtual buttons for the swim up, swim down, and surge actions where they make sense, and adenate the control with a minimum width of 64 pixels right next to the sprint button, since there aren't many buttons I can show instead. I also make sure to set the HBox container's minimum height to 64 pixels as well, so it doesn't disappear when none of these children are visible. Next, I go into the mobile control script, add an onRed reference to the player, and connect its movement state change signal to a new empty method. Then I add onRed references to all of the buttons, and in the new method I just created, I show or hide them based on the name of the current state. I want the jump button to be visible if the player is either swimming on the surface or not swimming at all, but for other grounded movement I just check if the player isn't in any of the swimming states. As for the swimming related buttons, I don't want the swim up button to be visible when swimming on the surface, and I only want the surge button to be visible when underwater. With the visibilities updated, the only thing left to do now is to force them to be released when they are being hidden. For that, I go into the virtual button script and move the release logic into a new method called _release. Next, I add a ready method and in it I connect the visibility change signaled to a new method called onVisibilityChanged, where I check if the control is hidden and if touch index isn't -1, and if so, I just call the release method to force release the action. After making sure to hide the mobile controls, I plug in my Android device and start testing it all out. Now I can start swimming when I jump into water and the buttons appear and disappear based on whether or not they're available. The animations and visual effects aren't perfect and it did take some effort to integrate all of these, but all in all I think it was quite easy. I hope it's been useful. With Godot 4 approaching beta, I'm planning to make a Godot 4 version of this controller, so please stay tuned. As always, you can find the links to the example project as well as all the assets used in this video in the description box below. Thanks for watching.